Good afternoon, everyone. For those of you, if someone does not know me, I am Judy Casey, the library director, and I want to say thank you for coming to our first Lunch and Learn of the season. This program is sponsored by the Friends of the Rogers Public Library, and they are so generous to the library. They donate everything from databases like lynda.com, where you can have online learning, to our kiosk over at the Rogers Activity Center, to ebooks and audiobooks. The list is endless. This room is named after them because the amount they donated during the expansion project in 2005. And just thank you so much for coming, and I want to thank them. Today, I do not have the brochure for next month out yet. We meet on the second Tuesday of each month from 12 to 1. As you can see, there's some cookies. We'll have drinks. I'll bring you lunch, and I see most of you did that. The flyer for next month, the Experimental House, if you haven't heard about it, is going to be our speaker next month, but we had a little trouble confirming it. It took a little longer, so we don't have the publicity piece from them, what they're going to cover yet. We will send out the email again, and we'll have flyers out here in the library with just a little bit more information about that coming up very soon. If you have suggestions for programs, you can feel free to let me know or to let Leslie Canarium know out at the information desk. She coordinates these programs and tries to make the arrangements for them with it. I'm going to introduce our speaker, and I'm afraid I'm going to slip off. I've had this crud with allergies and stuff that's going around, and periodically I'm coughing like I have tuberculosis, and you don't want to listen to a speaker while I'm doing that. So I'm going to go ahead and slip off. I say that, and I won't, you know, for the next hour. But I have been doing that pretty seriously the last few days on some antibiotics, so hopefully it'll start clearing up soon. Once again, welcome. And our speaker today is Madeline Samick from the Peel. Let me get it right, the Peel Compton Foundation and the Gardens, and we so appreciate her. I'm interested, I'm sorry I'm going to miss it. I really wanted to hear more about this. It is just a wonderful opportunity. We are so blessed in our community of all the many things that we have, and let's give Madeline a big hand.
I'm going to turn it off. Madeline,
okay.
Just push the button and
hope.
If you need it, let her know.
My name is Madeline Samick, like she said, and I'm from the Compton Foundation, the Peel Compton Foundation and Compton Gardens Site Manager. I've only been here since December, but I've been gardening almost my whole life. My mother and father traveled. My father was in the military and an army brat. I've gardened in Germany, I've gardened in Ohio, I've gardened in North Carolina, I've gardened much of my life in Florida. I used to train master gardeners in Florida, where I was a program assistant, horticulture program assistant, and I ran and managed 54 acres. So gardening in different areas is not unfamiliar to me. There are challenges everywhere. The other part of this I want to talk to you about, yes, it says gardening with wildlife, Arkansas natives. This doesn't mean I want you to turn your whole yard into natives. What I'm trying to do here is to encourage wildlife and using some of the Arkansas natives to help preserve it. I come from a state in Florida where there are more people than there are animals. It is crazy. They're building faster than they can build. They put people in them and they're still coming. If you get up, if the hurricane's not there, and you're coming in, let's say you're coming in from a vacation in South Carolina, the amount of people coming into Florida, it's scary. It's just scary. You want to say, stop, wait a minute, we're full. I don't want that to happen to Arkansas. And we have a lot of wildlife here. The birds are crazy around here. And I come from Florida, I've never seen so many birds. Butterflies, now in the fall, which is different for me. I'm used to them in the summertime, but they're here from the summer to the fall, and they're everywhere. So I have some of the same problems you do in your yard. I just bought a house in Garfield. Minimal plantings. Yes, it may be a little, I've got some acreage with it, but they're just minimal, what I call habitat-loving plants and nectar plants for birds and butterflies. So it's kind of, I'm in the same boat. So if you have any questions about how to landscape, we'll talk about that afterwards, but let's go ahead and start with some of our objectives here. Wildlife-friendly landscape using those native plants. Does anybody know what this one is?
Indian pink.
Okay, she's going to answer all of these. This one? Oak leaf hydrangea. What are these?
Conscious.
And that?
Coneflower.
Purple coneflower. Don't just use coneflower because coneflower describes a lot more, and you'll see some more as we go on. Already you're starting to see the variety of color and times of year. And that's also crucial for butterflies and birds. Okay, one more. Let's do it this way. That will be easier. All right, we have two objectives here. Create a wild-friendly landscape and identifying some of the common wildlife in residential landscapes. No, this isn't everybody. And no, I did not put the groundhog on here. Because I don't want him to be around.
Why not?
Because he eats everything. How do I know? We have one at Compton. They aren't kidding about the birds here. There are times of the year I can't walk out to my car where I parked it without saying, "Excuse me, everybody, can I get to the car?" I tried to get in my door, and a cardinal evidently was underneath my truck and came out and flew up and hit me in the face. So there are birds everywhere, and I'm talking some of the prettiest things I've ever seen. As far as butterflies, I'm beginning to see more butterflies here than I've ever seen before. More color is here. And then we have all those other ones that come and stay from the east and the west, that just find Arkansas that nice medium, if you know what I mean. Not too cold, not too hot, and then they're all of us that want to feed them. All right, this is a big economic impact for Arkansas. Everybody knows about the wildlife and the birds and the natural state. But we can help too, as homeowners. Okay. You can do within landscapes and neighborhoods. Bella Vista has a lot of birdhouses that they were telling me about, the bluebird houses on the golf courses. All the neighborhoods can start doing things like that, even in mediums. Notice the tier. Well, this house is not a very good picture up here. Better on the computer. You have different tiers and different levels for the wildlife to hide, to nest in, and to eat from. Now y'all stop if you have any questions when we get there. Right now this is what we need for them. We need food, water, and cover. How many people live on a lake? How many people live on a pond? How many people don't live on water at all? You're going to have to do something. But does it require major work?
You forgot creek.
And creek. Yeah, you live on a creek?
Yes.
Okay. Well, I work on a creek. Cindy Springs. All right. These are just two of so many. But the fruit and seed-bearing plants, native plants are good for this, allow insects, resources, and use environmentally friendly pest controls. Insecticidal soap, neem oil. Do you all realize that when you're using these chemicals to kill the ants, the fleas, the ticks, that you're also killing the butterfly, the honeybee, and all our other pollinators can get damaged. We have native bees here as well. So what I'm going to say to you is be selective of when you use some of those controls. I'm not saying not use them, because I know there are times that things get out of control. But what I'm saying is being selective. Instead of doing the whole yard for ants, do the ant hill. Kill the queen. Don't put it out all over your yard, because it's not a preventive. Does not prevent bugs from coming in. It's not selective. It will kill on contact. And the bees, if you're using 7 dozen, how many people grow their own vegetables? I do a lot of that. You're taking 7 dozen, sprinkle it right on the area that the bugs or mealyworms or tomato worms are on, and then the next 24 hours, wash it off immediately. What happens when the bees land on the poison or anything? They take it back the hive, and they kill the whole hive. So when you're putting all of that chemical down, you have to be careful. And I'm not saying don't put chemical down for fleas if they're really bad, but don't do it all the time. Do it like a one-shot deal. Does anybody know what that caterpillar is?
Is it a monarch?
It's monarch. It's on a swamp milkweed we have in the garden. It's a milkweed that likes damberries. How many people have damberries? I know I do. That does very, very well, like in a rain garden. We don't have it in a rain garden. We have it on the hill. Most of it's on a hill. And we have to water it to keep it going. But if you want to put it in that rain garden area or that damp area, that's an excellent plant. Tubular flowers will attract hummingbirds. Now, I don't know about you, but I just moved into my own property, and I was telling somebody over here that I have so many hummingbirds. I counted 20 in one evening. And they get to the window, and they look at you like, are you going to feed me? And I'm like, didn't know I was supposed to. I'll put one up tomorrow. But this, does anybody know what this is? I know Betty does. Anybody else? No, it's not honeysuckle. It's a trumpet vine. It's a type of trumpet vine. It's a cross vine, I believe. This up here is one of my favorites. And you'll see some more of these pictures at Compton Gardens if you go to our website and our Facebook page. That is Monarda. That is wild bergamot Monarda. Now, there's a lot of Monarda out there. That Monarda gets about a little taller than me. And has all these beautiful purple flowers on it. Not only does the hummingbird like the nectar, but the goldfinches like the seeds. So having a spot, it can be a backdrop plant in full sun. That's a great plant to have. Yes, sir?
So particularly on that Monarda that you're talking about, will that attract other things like butterflies?
Oh, yes.
And
it just doesn't attract the hummingbird. It's just the hummingbird's favorites.
So if you had something like that that the hummingbirds like, other things are going to like too.
Correct. So it has got pollen in there, and they'll all go for it. You may get, the bees can't get in there. The tube is too long. But anything like a butterfly can stick their tongue down in there.
Yeah. How big does that How big does it get?
It's about my height, a little taller. It can't get taller. It should be, if you're going to do an island, it should be the center plant. If you're going to do a back, make it the back tall plant. When you're back tall, if you're going to do a tier.
How is that spelled? M-I or M-E?
M-O.
M-O, okay.
N, Monarda. And it's wild Burma. There's lots of Monarda out here. The varieties are different. Some are short, some are tall, but it's wild Burma.
And does that then die off in the wintertime?
Yes, sir. And it reseeds itself and comes back up. Now, when I say these are natives and they reseed themselves, I'm not kidding. And you can dig them up and you can give them to friends. It'll help perpetuate it. You don't have to plant it all the time. It's in perennials. It recedes, and we burn the meadow. If you come out in late April, June, at Compton Gardens in our meadow area, you will see all this blooming. I'm going to try to have some for sale at the plant sale next April. It's the last weekend in April, and I'll try to have, I'm going to save some up this winter.
Can you get it now and plant it?
No, you can, but you're not going to get anything from it.
Well, right, but
you can order it online.
Next year. Mm-hmm.
American Meadows, and that's where I would start. Prairie Moon is another one, but I would order the seed and seed it up.
Does that need a lot of sun, or will it do?
Full sun.
Full sun.
Okay, we talked about water. There's the Knee Springs down at Compton Gardens, but up here, a simple bird bath. And it doesn't have to be pretty. It can be a shallow bowl for water. You'll see a lot of people put bricks or stones in there. Birds don't want to get completely wet all the time. And butterflies can't get in there. They like a flat surface to drink from. But now, mosquitoes. There's another thing here. You can buy these little round tubes, circular devices now in the stores, Home Depot and Lowe's both carry them. It will not hurt wildlife, but will kill the mosquitoes. But I also take, we try to clean ours every, once a quarter. I don't do it every month, I do it once a quarter. I would love to do it every month, but I work for a living, and you know how it is. Time happens. Things get busy. Okay, vertical layers are important. We talked about that early on. Notice up here, this is our meadow in March. And notice we have this size, then we have the backdrop a little higher, and then we have the trees. One of that has to do with, they want to go down and get the food, but then they want to escape somewhere. So when you're putting even a bird feeder out, you have to have it somewhere where the birds can escape if predators come and hide. Even bigger hawks come in and try to get the smaller birds, and you want to provide that protection for them. Does anybody know what this is? If you can see it very well. I've got it. This is a big hummingbird attractor. Ohio Buckeye or the Red Buckeye, either one. Now, I know most of you see a dead tree and want to cut it down. And you have to be aware of safety hazards, yes. But if you've got a little property, try to leave the snags. That's where the critters live. I know that there might be building restrictions, that you might have to take the trees down, all of that. But if you can leave one of the stronger, older trees that have got some dying on it, do so. This is where the animals live. It's all about repurposing. Okay. I got a funny story. I had a former boss. We had 54 acres, I remember I told you that? And he wanted some ducks. We have a pond. He thought he'd inspire some 4-H people to build some duck boxes. And we put them all around the pond for these crazy ducks that never came. Never came. We never had ducks. We had a gator. The gator would eat the ducks. So the next tree goes, well, let's put them up in the trees for the owls. No owls. None. Do you know what came in there? The big, pleated, red-headed woodpecker. They ended up being woodpecker boxes, which is cool to me, too. So the owl house, the duck house, and can be the woodpecker house. Some of these have dual purposes. But you do need to check the requirements for each species. The bluebird house is specific, and they like it just so. And you will have both bluebirds in them. They're becoming more urban. I went out when I was looking for a house. We went to Bella Vista. Oh my goodness, the bluebirds in Bella Vista. And the house, there are a lot of houses in Bella Vista. And there were tons and tons of bluebirds. So what used to be a field bird has now become urbanized, especially here. Make sure you've got the different heights too. Bluebird houses don't like to be any taller than this. You're gonna do, marlins are gonna be up. You know, you've got different sparrows. Might as well not, because they'll be hanging baskets, no matter what. They like hanging baskets. So put lots of hanging baskets up. Again, we talked about chemicals. Please watch how you use them. And on another subject time, when we ever talk about this, we're going to talk about invasive plants, remove them. Now, hold on. Any plant that likes its spot can be an invasive plant. Because what happens when it likes its spot? It kind of turns into this monster. I'm notorious for that. I had a plant in Florida called Bulbarian sunflower. You may look it up. It gets about 12 feet tall and bushes. Well, I thought it'd be cool because it's supposed to be an annual. In Florida, it's not an annual. It never dies. It just continues to get bigger, bigger. And my husband, I thought, said, you're not taking that to Arkansas. I said, well, Arkansas will die. You're not taking that to Arkansas. With your luck, it would stay in your yard and live. He hated it because I make him cut it down every spring. And we're talking stalks like that. And if it fell over, like let's say in a hurricane, wherever it fell, it rooted. So be careful. Some of the things that you truly love that like your spot, like your place, can get aggressive. You may want to pass it on to friends or get rid of it altogether if it gets too out of control. But there are invasive plants to Arkansas, please look them up when you go. Put in invasive plants of Arkansas, and I'll give you a whole list of them. Betty, can you name one?
Honeysuckle?
That's
I could name four. No, there's native Japanese honeysuckle.
There you go.
Japanese honeysuckle.
Wisteria?
Wisteria.
And I know everybody loves
English
wisteria.
Ivy? I could name 40.
Everybody loves wisteria. It's absolutely stunning. There is a native wisteria that's in South Arkansas that's stunning. I don't know if it will make it up here, but it's beautiful and it's not aggressive.
Do you have kudzu here?
Yes. Unfortunately, kudzu is everywhere. There's not a state I don't think it, even Alaska may have kudzu as far as I'm concerned.
I didn't think it survived the winter very well.
It morphs itself, I'm sure. All right, now listen, you got a pen, you can write these down, you can look these up as well, but any native nut tree, have at least one in your yard. Whether it's an oak, whether it is a pecan, whether it is a hickory, have one nut. You've got the Indian paintbrush, you've got the American elm, you've got the black gum, swamp chestnut, green ash, hackberry, longwood. You have some of the prettiest oaks here. pecan, southern magnolia, the southern red oak, white ash, and the white oak. The white oak is a stunning tree. It is absolutely beautiful. If you want to see some of these, please feel free to come to Compton Gardens. I will walk you around. We have bitternut. We have bitternut hickory. We have pignut hickory. We have Chinese chestnut, which is trying to, they're trying to work with, that's not a native. They're trying to work with a chicopin, the native chestnut, to see if they can do a hybrid. Chestnut blight wiped out the chicopins, almost wiped out the chicopins. And right now they're trying to have the cross made of the Chinese, which was not as susceptible to the chicopin. So we have a chicopin and we have a Chinese chestnut there as well. Now, some of you are going to say, I have enough trees in my yard, and I probably have at least two or three of those. Here's some shrubs. The American beautyberry, that bird's love. It is a native. It has purple berries on it. Come to Compton Gardens. We have lots of them. Oh, my goodness. They'll get about 10 feet. Shrub, bush, like full sun. Blackberry, blueberry. Red buckeye. We talked about the button bush. Oh my goodness, does that attract butterflies? That's this one right here. Now, I have personally not seen them any taller than 4 feet yet, but I'm sure they do get taller than that.
They need real damp area.
That's a damp, another one of those, you have that damp spot? Put that with the milkweed, I bet 10 to 1 that would be stunning. All right, elderberry, fringe tree, that's the one on the left here. I saw my tallest one I've ever seen in the mountains. It's on Hobbs, and it's absolutely beautiful. Golden currant. If you all want to know about golden currant, let's talk. Does anybody know what, besides Betty, does anybody know what golden currant is? Okay, it's a deciduous shrub. Early in the spring, like March, these wonderful little tiny yellow flowers get on there. And it smells like cinnamon, cloves, and your whole yard just comes alive with the smell. We have like 10 of these on the property. I walked by when I first got up here and go, I need this. It is, and it stays long. This isn't like witch hazel, which I like witch hazel too, but witch hazel will come and go pretty quickly. It stayed up until middle of April. There were still some at the plant sale this last year, at the end of April, still blooming. It is a shrub. It makes a great hedge. And boy, sitting out on your patio and smelling this, it's wonderful. And of course, how many know what a pawpaw is? No? Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. This is your native fruit tree. It is a banana-like texture inside and soft, and it's round about this big, and it takes the shade. This tree likes to grow in groups of three or more. And like, you can grow one, but it likes to have three or more. And it likes the shade. It's a medium-sized tree, about the size, a little taller than a dogwood. Absolutely wonderful tree to have, especially if you've got shade in your yard. It's an understory tree. And the fruits ripen right about now, or a couple weeks before, because I didn't get any at the office. People have all come through the trail and taken all the pawpaws before I got them. So we today, we have a special place in the garden now. We're not telling anybody, it's a secret. We planted 6. So I can have pawpaws next year. And according to Seraphim, who is the lead crew member, it's great for the stomach. That soft fruit is very healthy and very good for the stomach. All right, we've got some perennials here. The cardinal fern, the bean balm, this is that swamp milkweed I was telling you about. We have black-eyed seasons, gray-headed coneflower. This is, how many people have ever heard of gray-headed coneflower before? I know I have, some of us have. This is a lovely coneflower. It gets about this tall. Maybe some a little taller, yes. They can get taller. How much sun can you give it?
Full
sun. This is lovely. And by the way, the reason why they call it gray, to me it's green, but they swear it's gray. But it's really green until it begins to die. This head right here, I can't tell you how many goldfinch I am disturbed trying to get to these just to walk by them. Because as they go to sea, they're there. This is another beautiful cut. This is a great cut flower as well. All right, this is Rattlesnake Master. I know you all think that's a little crazy. Boys love it. It's one of the favorite things to do when I'm doing a kid's tour. They love this. It looks like it hurts. It doesn't. Now, the leaves may have some thorns on them, but the actual flower does not. And this attracts a lot of native bees. A lot of native bees. And I've even seen butterflies on them. And up there is our purple cone flower. To me, that gives you the antique look. It gives you, it's great cut flower. And again, finches. Okay, we have this walkway at Compton. You leave the house, the main house, and you walk down this walkway, and we've got it lined with cone flower. Well, Master Gardener, was it Master Gardeners we were walking with? We did that tour. We're walking through, and of course, this is now when the cone flower has gone to seed. We disturbed all these finches, and they were all along in here. And it was beautiful to see all the little finches just flying up in the air. It was just great. And there's Tall Blazing Star. That's Leatris. Everybody knows know that gets about that tall. It's purple, but what happens if they didn't really need staking? Because the wind is very wind vulnerable, it will tend to fall over, but you could stake it. We use bamboo hedges and fences. You can help hold it up. Tom the turtle, by the way. We want some frogs, eat all those mosquitoes. We want those lizards, they eat bugs too, bad bugs. Snakes, you're going, Madeline, we don't need snakes. Yeah, you do. You need to get those rats down. You need the rat snakes, you need the black snakes. The black snakes will eat the bad snakes. If you got a black snake in your yard, which is rare, I understand, up here, I came from it, wasn't. Keep it. Be happy that it's there. It's killing those bad copperheads and moccasins. You want those green snakes. They're eating the bad bugs, they're eating the rats, the mice, and everything else they could possibly think you don't want in your yard. And of course, our turtles, our birds, our foxes, our squirrels. Well, they can be a pest. But it's also nice to see them. When you don't have them, you miss them. Like, where are they? What's wrong? Why aren't squirrels there eating everything? Rabbits, I think they're nice, but I understand that they can be a pest. And you've got, again, everything can be a pest because there's too many. Bats. Do you know that bats eat a ton of mosquitoes at night? You want bats. Matter of fact, if you want to talk to me later afterwards and talk about putting a bat house in your yard, we'll talk about getting instructions to get somebody to build it for you. But it's got to be put up high in a tree or on a pole. But they are fabulous for eating all the mosquitoes at night. And of course, our wonderful butterflies. And that's the Monarda down there. Again, we were talking, wanted to know if it attracted anything else besides hummingbirds. There you go. Okay. Birds. Have you ever seen the indigo buntings? I did for the first time this year. It was in the meadow. I must have scared it because it flew up right in front of me, but it happily landed in the tree just right above and I can still see him. He's absolutely, unbelievably beautiful. I love that color. And there's my favorite goldfinch. But you got the Carolina wren, you got the blue bitch, you got the goldfinch, you got the mourning dove, you got the indigo, you got the red shoulder hawks, the cardinals, the hummingbird, Carolina chickadee, mockingbird, blue jay, barn owl, woodpeckers, and I forgot the eagles. But there's so many more birds that you can attract in your yard just by adding a few natives to dress it. And some of those perennials are stunning. I love them all. All right, nectar plants. Room to avoid arguments. In other words, plant more food, and I'm having arguments now with my bird feeder because I do not have enough nectar plants for the hummingbirds right now, but I'm working on it. The migratory, and make sure you have enough undercover and story plants for nesting. Okay, there are two plants needed for butterflies. You need the nectar, but you ought to have the host. And up on the far left is called the common milkweed. You see a lot of this. This is the orange milkweed. There are other varieties of milkweed that you can buy in the stores. But we're talking natives. Go ahead and buy the milkweed in the stores. They're not aggressive. But make sure they're good for zone 6. I know some of you might be in zone 7. But be safe. Make sure it's good for zone 6. All right, some butterflies have specific hosts. Nectar plants are shared with hummingbirds, pollinators, all sorts of insects, and visitors serve as food for wildlife. This little guy was picked up by a bird. And I like that because he was not a good insect. He was eating more than he was going to give back. Okay. Work with your neighbors to expand the natural habitats and some of the native plants. Create large patches. Educate other people that you've been here, you've talked to us. You all have just now been educated on stuff that probably people in the neighborhood don't know about. On flowers and other things that would attract some of the wildlife into their garden and what were the benefits.
Plug for our Friday morning tours.
Oh yes, well, we'll do that. Next week, starting at 10 a.m. on a Friday, every Friday until November, we're doing tours through Compton Gardens. We would love to have you, especially those people that have not been to Compton Gardens, to get to know the history of the house, why it's there, why Dr. Compton is so important to Northwest Arkansas. And they would love to take you around and show you all the plant life, the trees, and some of the landscape that we've done. Now there's a plant up here I have not talked about. There's so many I have not talked about. But I want you to think about, maybe write this one down. It's called Golden Alexander. Golden Alexander looks like, how many people know what Queen Anne's lace looks like? Okay, pretty much everybody. This is a yellow version. It's a little shorter, and it comes in a little earlier. But you plant the yellow golden Alexander first, and then the Queen Anne's lace, and mix it up, and then you have this. As one begins to fade, you have this yellow and white for a little bit, and then one begins to fade, and then you have it all white. First all yellow, then a nice mixture, and then you have all this white. And then throw some echinacea in there, and it will last most of the summer. It kind of gives you all that wonderful feeling, but that golden Alexander is that wonderful airy plant that gets about that tall. where Queen Anne's lace can get about this tall or taller. Yes?
Okay, so what, you know, with all these new plantings that we're going to be doing, what do you do about soil amendment? Because okay. Our soil is not really soil in the true sense. It's kind of like muddled rock.
Sure. Probably brought in, or it's probably what they call builder's mix, where they built all the sand and dirt to bring it in, and or they brought rock in there. I don't know if it was native rock.
In Bella Vista, it's all chert. It's all native. Sure.
You know, yeah, it's yeah. native because they yeah. use yeah. pickaxes to.
Well, one yeah. of the neat things about some of these native plants, they don't need a lot of amending. They love amending, don't get me wrong, if you want to put other things in there and you want to be companion plants, then you're going to have to amend. But these native plants don't need as much. How's that? We'll go with that area. They tend to like those rocks. If you come to Compton, come look where we've planted them all. Just come take a look in clay and rock. It's some of the worst digging I've ever seen. But these plants seem to love it. Now, you're going to add other things besides natives. And you want to do a garden, you're going to have to bring in dirt. And you just moved in, correct?
Yeah.
That means you have no compost set up.
Nope.
I'm going to put a plug in for Walmart. It's got the lowest manure, bag manure, around that I know of. Do you know anything cheaper?
No, I don't buy any of that stuff.
Well, composted manure. Yeah, well, and then save your leaves in the winter and put them in a pile in the back. And then turn them a couple of times, you're going to have compost in the spring. But until, if you're going to plant something now, you're going to have to do it, other than natives, you're going to have to amend the soil. And compost and a peat moss mixture would work fine, or compost in a leaf mixture would look really well. Yes?
I had a question. How do you get the golden alexander? Is by seed? Or
by seed, but I'm going to try to have some. The plant sale. Did you see any when it was blooming, Betty?
Yeah, I mean,
it's pretty.
Yeah, it's beautiful.
And it takes full sun.
How about sumac? What are your thoughts on sumac?
What kind of sumac? Poison sumac? I don't like it.
I think what I'm talking about is not poison.
It's a shrub.
Yeah.
A shrub. It's okay.
It gets like about like this.
It's okay. It's good though. The wildlife loves it.
Yeah.
It
can be kind of invasive though.
Well, like I said, any plant that likes its spot can be that way. When you purchase a plant such as that, you know that, right? So where you're going to put it will be key. And are you willing to keep up with it? That's the other thing. My husband and I were not willing to keep up with that crazy sunflower. I was, he was not. But then again, he was the one that always had to cut it. If you buy wisteria, if you do that, I love it. Understand the maintenance of that. That requires a great deal of maintenance. And sometimes, as a working woman, I'm going to tell you right now, I haven't been able to keep up with wisteria for about 30 years. And I've stopped buying it. As much as I love it, I've stopped buying it. Now, my former job, we had it, and I used to make wisteria jelly out of it. But we had over 250 master gardeners who'd help go out every spring and cut it, every summer and cut it, and every fall and cut it. I don't have 250 master gardeners, and I only have me, my husband, and my son. They're going to cut it. So when you put sumac in, and you know it's going to be aggressive, when you do that, make sure you understand what you're in for. Anybody else? Any questions?
We've lived here for 10 years now, in Bella Vista. And I listened to what you said about planting things. How do you keep the armadillos and the deer from taking what you've planted after you've planted it?
Well, some of the natives, they don't like, which is a nice thing. But you're right, there's a lot of that.
That's the problem we had, and we gave up after planting everything because we thought we're not going to waste our money.
I don't like to recommend products, and as a rule, I don't. But I can tell you right now what has been successful for us at Compton, and that's deer off.
Deer off?
Also,
actually, when that's been in our front yard. Our backyard has a fence, but the armadillos got in the backyard and took anything.
They don't like the smell of that either. It's a deterrent. It's not going to protect at all, but it is a deterrent. You also might want to try neem oil. A friend of mine who is one of the best seeders I've ever seen, she seeds everything beautifully. did neem oil.
Neem oil?
How do you spell that?
N-E-E-M.
Okay.
Oil. It is a organic oil that helps prevent fungus and things, but it's one of the nice results have been, we've seen, that it seems to deter it. Now, I'm not talking about 50 deer. It deters two or three. If you got 50 deer running through your yard, you got a real problem.
No.
I might have 50 deer. I live in Garfield, so. Yeah.
They eat everything.
And they love azaleas, and they love roses.
Yeah, okay.
Since you're talking about pests a little bit, when we first moved here a couple of months ago, she went and a bird feeder, and it was a non-finch feeders, and hummingbird feeders are kind of exempt from that, but she bought this huge, just, you know, wild feed mm-hmm. bird feeder,
I know.
And we stuck it in the ground. I mean, this is about that big around. It's plastic, it's heavy, and the first night after we planted it, we walked out there and, you know, something had bent it over.
Rats.
And, well, and, I mean, this is a pretty good metal pole. Had bent it over and gotten into it and kind of emptied it. So, figured, well, we'll have to secure it a little better.
And groundhogs.
Which we did. The second night after we did that, now it's bent over completely to the ground and it's gone.
First, the whole took feeder
it
away.
Is gone.
I want you to get a post, a wooden post, and I want you to get a call. Then you're going to have to fence it around and take care of it. You're going to have to put on a wooden. Everything I've seen here has been really sturdy. You can't do a shepherd's hook.
Right. Yeah.
It's not going to work.
Why do they even sell those damn
things? Because they're great for hanging baskets and rent houses. But they're not good for bird food.
Take your feeder in.
Now, I have a bird feeder out there, and I live in Garfield, and I've hung it from the old redbud tree. I don't know about the critters at night, and I have deer. Trust me, Garfield has a ton of deer.
Oh, yeah.
I have groundhogs. I have every critter you can think of out there. And I've hung it in the tree. And I put it on the S-hook and let it hang down so I can reach it. And that seems to have done it. There's enough food on the ground, evidently enough nut trees on the ground for the squirrels. Why did I tell you to put a nut tree in your yard? Mm-hmm. This might deter them from the bird feeder. Now, if you do have a bird feeder, understand something. When you have bird feeders, you will have rats. You will have raccoons. You will have deer. I'm just curious maybe to see what it is. Now, if you put nuts in it, they like nuts too.
Yeah.
Okay?
And, this did,
yeah. And they love sunflower seeds. Just love them.
Yeah.
So understand when you put them in there, you're going to have wildlife. But try to secure it enough so you can have use the S-hook and maybe keep the squirrels from going down the S-hook. I can't tell you they're not going to do what they are.
The other thing to do is take your feeder in at night.
You can take your feeder in.
Yeah.
That's what we do.
Yeah.
Now, right now, I don't have that problem. I have all these little birds I haven't identified yet that are coming to the bird feeder. Remember, I'm from Florida. I have new sounds. Yeah. I'm not used to have the bird sounds up here.
Yeah.
And I have new birds, and I'm trying to identify them all. I brought some books with me, too, that if you all want to look afterwards, that you could take pictures of and maybe order on Amazon for yourself to help you identify the flowers, help you identify the wildlife, and the pest. That might not be a bad idea.
Do you have any way to get rid of moles?
Mole bait and cats.
Mole bait didn't work.
No, cats. The same thing I said in Florida. We don't have moles in Florida too, and then we did cats. They aerate, just they're aerating it for you. mole bait, we're using mole bait at Compton and it seems to be doing the trick. But it's a constant thing. It's not something you just put down, they're all gone all of a sudden. Because those guys go everywhere. You're going to have to put them in several different spots and do it two or three times to get them to go and to die off. And there's more than one mole in your yard. If there's one mole, you got one, but you still got three others.
I've never had it before.
Yes, ma'am.
What is it that the rabbits want at the hospice? Is it the leaves or the
leaves?
Okay.
The leaves. But I would say deer being more after the hosta, but rabbits. Then put something else in the yard for the rabbits. You know, let's think about this. You know, I see rabbits downtown Bentonville. And all these beautiful homes have these vegetable gardens, and every time I see the rabbits hop into the vegetable garden, and I laugh. But it may be a great deterrent to put a few things out for them to keep them from coming to your plants. So you grow a little bit of lettuce that's got holes and the bugs are eating. The rabbits love it. You know, just think about feeding them a little bit of something else somewhere else in your yard, far away from your stuff. And let them have a little too. Otherwise, you're going to be an idiot. I love it. I laugh. The service road behind where I go, where the greenhouse is, these ladies, these families always have these gardens. And this is downtown Bentonville. And everybody's got a little garden. And I see rabbits hopping from house to house to house to house. And I'm thinking, I don't know if that's a deterrent or these people are really mad or rabbits up. But we do have hawks. And they sit on the branches of these trees that are dead. And they hunt. And they hunt all over Compton Gardens. I watch them. There's a patch right. Compton Gardens is here. This is a green space. There's a house here. And houses. This green space right here. Bunny tries to cross from Compton Gardens to green space. Doesn't make it. Hawk sits right there. Yep. So remember, if you're having some of those snags and things in your yard, then you have that wonderful thing called the hawk and the barn and the owls to help keep out the rodents.
Do the barn owls, do they operate at night?
Well, you're supposed to. That doesn't mean they will. Matter of fact, we can hear the owls in the morning when daylight comes up. And this is mating season. Just want to let you know it's mating season for owls. And they hoot all day and all night. Have you ever seen a horn owl? They're huge. And the wingspan, when they land in front of you, scares you to death. You think you're being picked up by a dinosaur or something. These things can pick up cats, small dogs, and will on many occasions. So when you do have all this wildlife going on, which is a good thing, just know that you're going to have to take extra care of your animals as well, your domestic animals. Anything else? Any more? Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate it.